Hello everyone, I am Dr. Osman reporting once again from the University of KwaZulu-Natal, South Africa, the premier university of African scholarship. Today's lecture is more of a continuation of the previous lecture. In the previous lecture, we looked at multi-unit systems and you've learned how to construct a degree of freedom table and solve a basic multi-unit problem. And now today's lecture will be about, today's lecture will deal with splitters and mixers, which are specialized considerations, and we look at how they will affect our degree of freedom table. And also we will talk a bit more about the homogeneity of material balance problems and how we can use homogeneity to solve certain problems that could otherwise not be solved. I'm talking specifically about the use of a basis, applying a basis, and also relocating a basis, and we'll look at an example on that. Okay, so let's get to it. Now we shall focus on some special considerations, and this section concerns particularly recycle streams containing mixers and splitters. Okay, as you may know, many processes employ recycle streams where a portion of the product is recycled in order to ultimately improve the purity of the product. And a recycle unit typically has a basic setup of having a feed coming in, going into a mixer, then going into your unit in question, whether it be a separation unit or a reactor. And thereafter, the product stream is split. So we have a product retrieval, and part of this product is recycled and mixed with the feed. Now, these particular units, the mixer and splitter, deserve some special attention because they have certain material balance qualities. The mixer itself isn't really special. Physically, a mixer could just be a T-junction in a pipe. Okay, a simple T, where we have two streams being mixed, or a mixer can ultimately be a tank, a stirred tank, where we have multiple feed streams and a single product stream. In the case of a mixer, the flows of the feed all add up to the product, which is not something unusual. In terms of the compositions cannot be determined. They can be determined, but they are not equal to the feed streams. The splitter, on the other hand, is a slightly more complicated unit. Physically, it can also just be a T-junction in a pipe. That's a case of a feed being split. In this case, there's no control of the split, so we can assume an approximate 50-50. Or our feed could go into a tank and we can have a split off there, perhaps with valves to control the split ratio. Now, in the case of a splitter, even though the flow is split, of course the sum of the flows will equal to the feed. Even though the feed is split, the compositions will be the same in every stream. Okay, so that amounts to a subsidiary relation. But how many subsidiary relations are we looking at here? That is the big question. Okay, so the splitter conditions can be translated into a set of subsidiary relations valid for each component I. Okay, so if we consider this diagram here, we have a feed and it's split off into stream 2, stream 3, any number of product streams. We'll note that for any species I, our compositions will be the same. The composition of I will be the same in each stream and all equal and equal to the feed stream. Okay, so that's for each species I. However, only S minus 1 relations of these will be independent. And if the splitter divides a stream into n branches, n minus 1 conditions like this one here will hold. Okay, so that's illustrated in this diagram here. So we have n minus 1 streams, n plus 1. N splits and for S number of species. And we could actually test this and write out all of the balances on the splitter, and we will find that only S minus 1 will be independent, and that too for N minus 1 branches. Therefore, the total number of splitter conditions for an S component system is then n minus 1 multiplied by S minus 1, where n is the number of streams that the feed was split into and S is the number of species in that feed stream. Okay, just some notes. Remember that our compositions are the same. X1i is equal to X2i, okay, between stream 1 and stream 2. And X1i is equal to X3i for stream 3, because it's all the same type of split. They may be true, but they are not necessarily independent. Okay, they result from a material balance over the splitter. And the latter has to be written as for any other unit of the system. Okay, so similarly, we get the same case for a mixer as well. We have certain relations, but none of them are independent. So in the case of the mixer, there is no real special consideration. There's no subsidiary relations for the mixer. However, there are relations for the splitter. And our subsidiary relation is equal to the number of streams split minus 1 multiplied by the number of species. Okay, so we have this. This is n streams and s species in the feed stream. Okay, so let's consider an example. Okay, we have a typical distillation column with a reflux, and as you move on and study mass transfer and separation processes, you'll note that this is a typical setup of a distillation column. You have your feed coming in and the distillate is drawn off the top of the column. It is condensed and partially sent back into the distillation column to facilitate contact between liquid and vapor. So a condenser is used. Remember, a vapor comes up from the column, it's condensed into a liquid, and part of that liquid is sent back as reflux. Okay, and we are given certain specifications. We are given the feed flow rates, the feed composition. We are told that there is a split ratio of 60%, 60% reflux. We are given the distillate flow and compositions. And they want us to calculate
all unknown flows and compositions. Another thing to note is that in the case of the condenser is not a separation unit. It merely changes the phase of stream 2 from a vapor into a liquid. So we can ignore that in our material balance calculations. Once we get to energy balancing, then the condenser will gain some precedence. Okay, remember now that the splitter has two streams, the two output streams, so N will equal to 2, and the feed stream has three components, so S is equal to 3. So the number of splitter restrictions is, of course, your M minus 1 multiplied by S minus 1, so that's 2 minus 1 times 3 minus 1, and that's equal to 2. Although there are the distillation column, the condenser, and the splitter, in the material balance context, there are only two units, the column and the splitter. So let's look at a degree of freedom analysis for this unit. Okay, so here's our degree of freedom table. Let's count the number of stream variables for the column. Okay, it's just counting the number of components. We have 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And remember, the stream is being split. So it will be 10, 11, and 12. Okay, so that's 3, 6, 9, and 12. In terms of the number of balances, we have a maximum of 3 components associated with the column, so the number of balances will be 3. There are 2 specified compositions. However, there is no flow specified. In terms of subsidiary relations, the reflux ratio is considered as a subsidiary relation because it is relating the flow of stream 4 to stream 2. 60% reflux essentially means that 60% of N2. Sorry, N4 is equal to 60% of N2. So let's consider that. Since we are not dealing with the splitter at this moment, we are dealing with the column, so we ignore the splitter restriction here. And ultimately, we get 12 minus 3 minus 2, which is a degree of freedom of 6. Okay, so the column is quite highly underspecified at the moment. Let's look at the splitter. For the splitter, we have 3, 6, 9 variables. Once again, 3 balances. In terms of composition, we have 2 specified compositions and 1 specified flow. The reflux ratio is also a valid subsidiary relation for the splitter because it is relating two streams that are joined to the splitter. So we can consider that. And our splitter restrictions, remember, it is 2 minus 1 multiplied by 3 minus 1, the number of streams that it was split into, and 3 is for the number of actual components in our stream. Okay, so that's 2. So we have 9 minus 3, minus 2, minus 1, minus 1, minus 2. Okay, so that will give us a degree of freedom of 0. So the splitter is well specified. Now if we can count for the process, number of stream variables, we have 3 plus 3, that's 6, plus 3, that's 9, plus 3, that's 12, 13, 14, and 15. We can add the number of balances, that's ultimately 6. We have 4 specified compositions, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 1 flow. The reflux ratio must be considered once, as well as the splitter restriction. Okay, and this will give us a degree of freedom of 1. Which ultimately means that this particular process is underspecified. No matter what we do, even if we solve for the streams around the splitter, we ultimately won't be able to solve for all of the compositions and flows. In any case, let's look at the overall. Overall, we have just 3 streams to worry about, the feed stream and the 2 product streams. So we have 9 variables. Once again, 3 balances. We have 4 compositions specified, as well as 1 flow. The reflux ratio does not concern any relationship between our feed stream and our 2 product streams, so it is ignored, and the splitter restriction is also ignored. Okay, and that will give us a degree of freedom of 1. Okay, and that is how the splitter will be handled. Okay, so we just need to be wary of how it counts as a subsidiary relation when dealing with a splitter in the table, and also the various relationships when writing out our balances. If the problem was slightly different, and it was specified, for example, that there is no acetone in stream 5, then we would have a change in our column, where we would ultimately have 11 stream variables and a degree of freedom of 5. This type of information would also result in ultimately less variables for the process, making the process solvable, a 0 degree of freedom. And the overall would also change. Okay, we'd have 8 stream variables and a degree of freedom of 0 here. So we could actually start our material balances either with the splitter or with the overall balance. Okay, writing out our splitter balances. Okay, in terms of a total balance, we note that our feed coming in, N2, will of course be equal to N3 plus N4. And N3 is specified as 700. So that's our total balance there. We can write similar balances for acetone. Okay, so for acetone we have X2A times N2, and that is equal to 10% times 700 for stream 3 plus the output of stream 4, which is X4A times N4. And a similar approach for acetic acid. Remember that we also have our subsidiary relation, the reflux ratio, where N4 is equal to 0.6 of N2, 60% reflux. In terms of our splitter restrictions, we can write both for acetone and acetic acid. X4A is equal to X3A, which is equal to 0.1. And for the acetic acid, it will be 0.88. So by knowing this information here, and by knowing that the unit is a splitter, we will ultimately be able to obtain the composition of our feed stream and also our other product stream or our reflux stream. Okay, so X2A will equal to X3A will equal to X4A. X2 of acetic acid will equal to X3 of acetic acid, which is 0.88. And that will also equal to X4 of acetic acid, which is 0.88. So by taking these considerations into account, we can solve the balances for N2 and N4. And ultimately we obtain these equations. Even if you wanted to prove it to yourself, you could use material balances and you can prove that your X2A is equal to X3A, which is equal to 0.1. But now that we have this knowledge of our splitter, we didn't need this calculation at all. And once these compositions and flows have been found, we can proceed as normal with our column balances. Okay, where this is our total balance, our feed and our reflux will be equal to our outputs. And we can draw similar balances for acetone, acetic acid, or if you want the acetic anhydride. Okay, and ultimately we can solve for stream 5. Okay, and as I mentioned before, the composition of stream 2 could be found without any calculation, simply by inspection, since the condenser or the split, neither the condenser nor the splitter can change the composition. Okay, now in the next example, we see that a splitter and mixer need not necessarily be used only for recycle loops. They can also be used for bypass loops. Okay, so in this example, we have fresh orange juice, which is originally containing 12% of dissolved solids, 12% of sugar, and it's being concentrated in an evaporator. under vacuum. And in order to compensate for the loss of flavor during the evaporation, 10% of the fresh juice or 10% of the feed is being drawn off initially and re-added to the product. Okay, so 10% bypasses the evaporator and is added to the product. If the process feed rate is 10,000 kilograms per hour and they're giving the outlet juice containing 80% dissolved solids, we would like to know the water evaporation rate and the composition of the final product. Okay, and this is our setup here. Okay, this is our bypass. So instead of splitting off the product and sending the stream back to the feed, in this case we are splitting the feed and sending a part of the feed to the product. Okay, this is a bypass loop. Remember that the mixer doesn't incur any subsidiary relations, however the splitter will incur subsidiary relations. In addition to its subsidiary relation on composition, we are told that we have a split ratio of 10%, which amounts to an additional subsidiary relation. Okay, keep this in mind. When looking at a splitter, we might not only have the splitter restriction as the subsidiary relation, we can have additional relations as well. So don't immediately just go to the degree of freedom table and pre-calculate everything for the splitter. So let's look at our degree of freedom table. Okay, I think I should get a bigger diagram here. So let's focus on our splitter. If we count the number of components, it's just sugar and water. Well, essentially sugar and water. So we will have two components here. So that's two and two components here, as well as two components here in the cutback. So that's 2, 4, and 6 stream variables for our splitter. And because there are a maximum of 2 components, so our balances will be 2. Let's look at our number of specified compositions and flows. We have 1 flow and 1 composition being specified. We were also given a split ratio, which counts as a subsidiary relation. And now let's look at our splitter restrictions. Okay, it is split into 2 streams. So N is equal to 2, and we have 2 species. So S is equal to 2. So our splitter restrictions, right, N minus 1 times S minus 1, that is equal to 2 minus 1 times 2 minus 1. So we just have a splitter restriction of 1. Okay, and this provides for a degree of freedom of 0. Let's look at the evaporator. We have 2 components here plus another 2, so that's 4, and only water here, so we have 5 stream variables. A maximum of 2 components, so there will be 2 balances. We have 1 specified composition for the evaporator and no flows. and no subsidiary relations associated with the evaporator. So we have a degree of freedom of 5 minus 2 minus 1. So that's a degree of freedom of 2. So we definitely can't start our material balancing from the evaporator. Now let's look at our mixer, which is our final unit. We will have 2 plus 2 plus 2, so that's 6 stream variables once again. 2 balances as before. We have just one specified composition and no flow. And no subsidiary relations. So our degree of freedom is 6 minus 2 minus 1, which makes 3. Now let's look at our entire process. The number of variables, let's count it once again. 2 there, plus 2, so that's 4. 6 plus 1 is 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. So that's 11 for our process. Maximum of 2 components still. So, oh no, sorry. For the process, we can add our balances. So that's 2 plus 2 plus 2. So that's 6. In terms of our specifications, we have one flow being specified and 2 compositions. Remember, in the process, all subsidiary relations must count. So that's naturally 1 and 1. And our degree of freedom is 11 minus 6 minus 2 minus 1 minus 1 minus 1. So that's a degree of freedom of 0, which means that the process is definitely solvable. What about the overall balance? There are only 3 streams associated with the overall balance: stream 1, 4, and 6. So in our stream variables, we have 2 here, plus 2, that's 4, plus 1 is 5. So that's 5 variables, maximum of 2 components, so 2 balances. There is one flow and one composition specified. And no subsidiary relations relating to these streams specifically. So we have a degree of freedom of 5 minus 2 minus 1 minus 1. That's a degree of freedom of 1. So in this particular example, the only option would be to start our material balancing from the splitter. Okay, and I think I should just leave that to you as homework. So make sure you watch this video again and again until you understand the various rules associated with multi-unit systems, how to draw up a degree of freedom table. As you can see in these examples, I've conveniently had these degree of freedom tables pre-written. Please take note of all of these things, because you will likely need to write up this degree of freedom table on your own, and write up and list your subsidiary relations on your own as well. Finally, let's look at an example that illustrates the effects of the homogeneity of our material balance processes. Recall with homogeneity that it doesn't really matter what our feed flow rate is, we should be able to obtain the same compositions. Recall that in a previous discussion, we noted that even if there was no flows given, we could assume a flow and calculate the entire process compositions. Now let's look at another effect of homogeneity. Okay, so consider this example. We have a 4-unit separation train and we have a feed of 1,000 moles per hour of a hydrocarbon feed containing C1, C2, C3 and C4 hydrocarbons. Okay, we are given the full composition of the feed. And they want us to calculate all the stream flow rates in the process, assuming that the recycle to unit 1 is 50% of the bottoms from unit 2. So they are giving us a reflux ratio here. Okay, so let's look at this process. Okay, so that's our feed coming in to unit 1. And we have a separation from C1 to C4, so we only get C1 to C3 coming out at the top. And that is further separated into C1 and C2 at the top. And a mixture of C1 to C3 at the bottom. Of course, very little C1 over here because most of the C1 is at the top. And we have a splitter. So note that the composition shown in stream 7 will be valid for stream 6 and stream 5. Okay, the bottom of unit 1 contains C2 to C4 and that is further purified, okay, to get C2 to C4 at the top here with very little C4. And C3 and C4, which is finally separated to a 98% purity of C3 and most of the C4 coming out the bottom. Okay, so we have 100% of C4 coming out here. And our objective, of course, is to find out what the flow rate is in each of these streams. So where do we begin? How do we start with this problem? We have information all over the place once again. So we need to draw up a degree of freedom table in order to figure out where we can start with our material balances. Okay, so I've drawn up a degree of freedom table for all of my units, unit 1 to unit 5, the process and the overall. Okay, and I've listed my common listings. And I have noted that from the diagram we have a splitter, and from the actual statements we have been given a recycle ratio. So we can expect to see these two subsidiary relations in these units and in this process. So let's look at unit 1 firstly. Okay, in the case of unit 1 we have 4 plus 3, that's 7, 8, 9, 10. 10 variables, and we also have a stream 6 coming in and that will contain 3 here. So that's 4 plus 3 plus 3 plus 3. That will give us 13 stream variables coming in. We have a maximum of 4 components associated with unit 1. So we have 4 independent balances. Let's look at our compositions. Our compositions are a bit tricky here. We have 3 specified compositions here and 1 here. However, note that nothing was said about stream 6. However, we know that this unit is a splitter, So we can expect the same compositions of stream 7 to occur in stream 6. So in total we have 3 plus 1, 4, plus 5 and 6. Okay, so we have 6 specified compositions. Okay, please make sure that you understand why I'm saying 6 compositions. Okay, due to the splitter. Okay, so I will write it in this form here, 4 plus 2. In terms of our flow, we have been given one flow to unit 1. And our subsidiary relations are not applicable to unit 1. So ultimately, we have a degree of freedom. Subtracting all of this from 13, we get a degree of freedom of 2. Now let's look at unit 2. We have 3 variables here, 4, 5. And since we know that this is a splitter, we know that we have these components coming out here, so we will have these components in here as well, although at a different flow rate. So that's 3, 6, 7, 8. Okay, we have a maximum of 3 components associated with unit 2. So we have 3 balances. Regarding our composition specifications, we have 1, 2, plus these 2 here, because this is a splitter. Okay, so we can write it like this, 2 plus 2. There is no flow, and also our subsidiary relations are irrelevant to this particular unit. So ultimately we have a degree of freedom, 8 minus 3 minus 4, which is 1. So now let's look at unit 3 coming down. Okay, so we have, it's quite simple, we have 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 stream variables, a maximum of 3 components. So that is 8 variables and 3 balances. There are 2 composition specifications, so that's 2, no flows and no subsidiary relations, so that will give us a degree of freedom of 3. Okay, regarding unit 4, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 stream variables, a maximum of 2 components, so there's 2 balances, 2 composition specifications and no flow, and no subsidiary relations applicable. So for unit 4 we have 5 minus 2 minus 2, which is 1. Now for unit 5, or the splitter, note that since we are told what's coming out of 7, the same components will occur in stream 5 and 6, so we have 9 stream variables, a maximum of 3 components, or 3 balances. We have been given 2 composition specifications. Okay, in stream 7, no flows. We have been given a recycle ratio. So that will count for 1. And our splitter restrictions. Okay, so our N is equal to 2 and our S is equal to 3. So 3 minus 1 multiplied by 2 minus 1. Okay, so 3 species and split into 2 streams. So that will be 3 minus 1 multiplied by 2 minus 1, so that's 2. Okay, and our degree of freedom is 9 minus 3 minus 2 minus 2 minus 1. That's a degree of freedom of 1. Okay, now let's count for the process. Okay, there's quite a lot to count for the process because it's quite complicated. So we have 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29. So that's 29 stream variables. Okay, regarding the number of independent balances, we can simply add up 4 plus 3 plus 3 plus 2 plus 3. So we have, for the process, 15 balance equations. If we can look at the specified compositions, okay, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Okay, so that's 10 compositions and 1 flow. We have the subsidiary relation and also splitter restrictions, adding on another 2. Okay, recall that for unit 1, I have listed these 2 compositions. However, for the process, I did not, because they are listed in the splitter restrictions. Okay, so performing the subtraction, we get a degree of freedom of 0, which means that the process is indeed solvable. However, things are not looking good because we don't have a degree of freedom of 0 for any of the individual units. Let's see if the overall balance offers some grace. Okay, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15 stream variables. Maximum of 4 components. In terms of our specified compositions, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay, and 1 flow. Okay, our subsidiary relations are not applicable here. They don't relate to any of the outer streams. So ultimately, we have a degree of freedom of 2. Okay, so we have a case where our process has a degree of freedom of 0, which means that the process is solvable, the entire system is solvable. It is possible to obtain all of our flows and compositions. However, we still don't know where to start because none of our degree of freedom for our individual units or for our overall balance is 0. So now what do we do? And this is despite the fact that we have 1 specified flow. Okay, and if we have 1 specified flow, that means that we can't just simply assume a basis and things will just fall into place. We can't just assume a basis and make one of these units 0. Or can we? Note that for unit 1, although we have a flow rate, we still have a degree of freedom of 2. Wouldn't it be really convenient if we had a flow instead for unit 2? Or for unit 4 or 5. That would add on 1 specification and make the degree of freedoms 0. Okay, so that's an idea. So let's investigate this idea. So let's say, for example, that this flow specification was not given. We don't have a flow rate here. But instead, we have a flow rate, perhaps over here, for unit 2, at stream 5. That would indeed make our degree of freedom for unit 2 0. Okay, so let's look at our action plan. We are relocating our bases from unit 1 to unit 5, which is the splitter. And we are saying N5 is equal to 1,000 moles per hour. We are completely neglecting this N1 being equal to 1,000. Okay, so we must just forget about this N1 being 1,000 for now and just let N5 equal to 1,000. And now let's see if we can solve the material balances. Okay, so we let our N5 equal to 1,000, which means that we could either solve for unit 2 or for unit 5, the splitter. So let's solve for the splitter and see what unknowns we can achieve or obtain the answers for. Okay, so that's our total balance on the splitter. And note that we also have a recycled ratio. So since we know what N5 is, we can get N6 and thereafter N7. And we are already given the compositions. That's quite trivial for a splitter. So we've easily solved the splitter using our newly introduced bases. We can also solve unit 2, which is the distillation, the separation unit here. Okay, using a total balance as well as a balance on the C3 and C2. Okay, that's simply what goes in must come out. Okay, C3 does not exist in the overhead here. So that's an easy balance. So by a straightforward calculation, we can obtain N2 and N4, as well as the unknown composition in stream 2 over here. Now, once we've obtained some information pertaining to stream 2, okay, we've obtained a flow rate and the composition, and we know the flow rate here. So we should be able to do a balance on unit 1. Okay, and here are the balances for unit 1. That's the total balance, and the balances for C1, C3, and C4. We could also do a balance for C2 instead of doing a balance for C4. That depends on your preference. And by solving the system, we obtain flow rates for stream 1, stream 3, as well as compositions in stream 3. And now once we've obtained information for stream 3, then we can proceed with a balance for unit 3. And ultimately, for unit 4 as well. Okay, so these are the balances for unit 3, and we can solve for N8 and N9. And using the unit 4 balances, we can solve for N10 and N11. So those are our flow rates, all completely solved. However, these flow rates are solved only in the case assuming a basis of N5 being equal to 1,000. However, this was not the original specification. So we need to rescale this problem. Note that when we assumed a basis of N5 being equal to 1,000, using the unit 1 balances over here, we obtained a value for N1 of 11,633, which is quite far off from the 1,000 that was originally given to us. So therefore we need to apply a ratio or a conversion factor. So let's consider the original N1 that was given and the calculated N1, and we apply a conversion factor. So thereafter, once we have this factor, we can simply multiply all of our flow rates with this factor. And there it is here. Okay, also note that although there's our original flow rate and all of our flows, our compositions do not change because of the homogeneity.
And that, ladies and gentlemen, concludes our illustrative examples on material balancing in the case of non-reacting systems. And please check on our learning website, the university learning website, for tutorials and further examples, as well as your notes, which contains many more examples and discussions. For those of you watching this from the outside using exclusively a social network, please leave a comment below if you want any supplementary notes to understand this further.